Hi everyone, and welcome to the last part of Level 3 of our second lesson in Spreadsheets for Business. In this video, we'll explore Excel's ability to generate random numbers in order to simulate a business scenario that'll help us make an educated decision on whether to test all of the snowboards that we manufacture or not test them, and then just pay for all of the costs associated with handling return defective boards. In the last video, we determined the cost of testing the boards, so in this video, we'll focus on how much we expect to pay for defective snowboards. In order to do this, we need to know the ranges of costs that we would expect to pay for defective boards returned by our customers. We know from previous experience that the return cost varies from between $25 and $200, depending on the location of where the board is shipped from. We also know that we can expect a failure rate between 3% and 5%. What we need to do is take this information and run what we call a simulation and find out whether the total cost would be more or less than the cost we found for testing every board before we ship them over here on this page. If it costs less to deal with the return skis and replace them than the testing costs, then it might be better not to test any of them. If it turns out that it will cost more to return all of the defective boards than to test them, then it would be wiser to test all the boards before we ship them out. What we have here to begin with is the average cost of 100 returned boards. The way we calculate this up here in the formula bar, we find the average failure rate and divide this by the average of the return costs, and then multiply this by 100 boards, 100 samples. To generate a simulation, we need to populate this table with random data that simulates the reality of these numbers over here. We need to generate random data for style, return costs, probability of failure, and then use this random data to determine the cost associated with each of these 100 samples. To generate a random number for the style, we see over here that we have three different styles of 1, 2, and 3. These numbers correspond to A, E, and R, respectively. We can do this with a function called RANDBETWEEN. The RANDBETWEEN formula requires two parameters, one for the bottom or low value, and one for the top or high value. This formula will generate an integer between the bottom and top parameters, inclusive of the two parameters, like so. If we copy this formula down, we now have 100 randomly generated styles from 100 manufactured boards. Next, we want to generate a random return cost. You might think that RANDBETWEEN will work, so let's try it out. Equals RANDBETWEEN, left parentheses. We could type in 25 here, but I always like to refer to cells containing this data rather than hard code the numbers into the formula. So I'll click on these cells over here for the bottom and top parameters. If I copy this formula down, you'll see that we generate whole dollar amounts for this column. This is a step in the right direction, but in order to be more accurate, I'd like to use decimal values so I can accurately catch the pennies as well. Let me undo this by hitting Ctrl Z. Since RANDBETWEEN won't work because it only generates random integers, we need to use its cousin, the RAND formula. RAND is the random function that, as we can see here in the formula, that returns a random number less than or equal to 0 and less than 1. The maximum number we get out of this is therefore 0.99999, a whole bunch of nines. And the lowest number will be 0. Let me hit Enter and copy this formula down so you can see what it looks like. However, comma, this doesn't quite work for us as we don't want the lowest to be 0. We want it to be 25 because that's the minimum replacement cost. So the way we do it is to just add 25 to this formula. Now let's copy that formula down and see where we are. Looks like we have a bunch of random data between 25 and 25.999999. That's also a step in the right direction, but we need this data to be randomly generated between 25 and 200. The way we handle this is to perform a little mathematical trick here and we multiply this RAND function by 175. We'll go ahead and do this to show you the desired result for now. Hit enter and copy this formula down, and it looks like we get the desired results. Let me look at this formula just to talk you through what's happening in it. Keeping in mind that this RAND function generates values between 0 and a bunch of 9s, if this is 0, then 0 times 175 is 0, and then we add 25 to it, which gives us 25. Cool so far? If this RAND function generates a 0.99999, then this value is pretty close to 175, and then we add 25 to it and get a number very close to 200. If I take this formula and use the round formula that we previously worked on, then we'll get the desired results of generating numbers between 25 and 200, rounded to the nearest penny. So right in here we type in round, then left parentheses, then come here to the end and put in a comma. The number of decimal places that I want is 2, so it's rounded off to the nearest penny. Finish it off with the dreaded right parentheses, and we're good to go. Or are we? We could leave this 175 here in our formula, but this 175 was arrived at by taking this maximum replacement value and subtracting the minimum replacement cost cell. So I'm going to build that out mathematically here so that our formulas continue to work if these values over here are updated or changed to new values. So here in the top parameter, I'll instead put this parentheses here and then take the maximum value minus the minimum value, and I want to put the dollar sign in front of those 12s so that when I copy it down, they don't turn into 13 or 14 or anything crazy like that. And then I see this 25 is hard-coded in here, so I'm going to take that out and instead click on that cell, I12. Again, put the dollar sign in there, so we got the minimum. And then we'll have the two decimal places that I want to round it to. Hit enter. Let's see, let's make that currency and copy that down. Let's see, I want to take all these dollar signs out of the second row and below, so I click on that. Control shift down arrow takes me to the bottom. And then I think I'll come up here and take out those dollar signs and hit OK. Now let's move on. To generate simulation data for the probability of failure, I'm going to follow the same procedure just for these cells here. We want to generate random numbers between 3 and 5%. So right off, we should now know that we'll be using the RAND instead of the RAND between function, since we'll be working with decimal values. Let's start off with equals RAND parentheses, then add the minimum value to this part. Now let's multiply the RAND part of the formula by the difference between the max and the minimum expected failure rates. I'm not as concerned about using the round function here, since we aren't working with dollars and cents, but rather fractions between 3 and 5%. Let's just adjust the formatting here by clicking on the percent icon on our toolbar. And just for the heck of it, I'll add a couple of extra decimal values just to give me more of a visual clue as to what's going on in this column. I'm going to copy the formula down by double-clicking on the fill handle, and we're good. Finally, we'll calculate the probable cost for each of these 100 simulated boards. This cell here is going to be equal to the return cost times the probability of failure. We'll fill the formula down, adjust the formatting to get rid of these dollar signs, and that's it for that column. Finally, over here, we'll add up the simulated costs for each of the three models using the SUMIF function that we learned in our last lesson. Equals SUMIF, highlight the range here in the style column, from the top down to the bottom here, comma. For the criteria, we just refer to this cell, comma. And finally, we select the range of numbers that we want to sum up for each of the style ones. So for style one, we have this random number here. This formula works well, so we want to be able to copy it down. In order to alter the relative referencing into mixed referencing, like we learned in lesson one, we'll need to lock these row numbers in place so they don't increment as we copy the formula down. So I'll put a dollar sign here in front of the row numbers in each of these two ranges in the formula. Here, 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 and here. Hit enter, and then drag this formula down to styles 2 and 3. We now have the sum of the three styles, so let's add them up here in this cell. Equals sum, parentheses, these three cells right here, right parentheses, and enter. We see here that this number is greater than the testing cost back on this other page, so that means that it's cheaper to test all of our snowboards prior to shipping rather than replacing defective boards out in the field. One quick note before we end this lesson. We need to demonstrate a couple things about how these random calculations work. As you may have noticed, every time we do anything in any cell and hit enter, all of the random numbers regenerate. Let me just put an X in here and hit enter. X, 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 X. See? While this is a good behavior most of the time, there may come a time when you want to get a random set of data that you want to freeze in order to analyze it a bit. If you look up here on the Formulas tab, down here on the right, click on Calculation Options. The default behavior is thankfully automatic. But if we click on the manual here, your entire spreadsheet now stops recalculating everything. Random number generators, as well as every formula on your entire spreadsheet. See, if I come over here and put 2 in this cell, 2 in this cell, and then put a sum formula in here and hit enter, you don't get anything. You'll see that this formula doesn't even work. Nothing on the whole page will calculate again until you go back up to the top here and click on the Calculate Now icon, or if you're into keyboard shortcuts, the F9 key. If you just want to run the calculations on this sheet, here's an icon that does that for you. Let me put the spreadsheet back in automatic mode, and I'll show you another way of capturing a random set of data that becomes static in such a way that we can analyze it without putting the whole spreadsheet into manual mode. Since this data is now back to re-randomizing, we can capture one sample of this data by copying it and then doing a paste special over here and then selecting values and number formats here because I want to keep all of our cool formatting. Now the original formulas continue to generate random data over here, but we have a captured set over here if we need to do work on it. One additional thing I'd like to do here is see how random this random number generator is. Is this one value indicative of everything? So if I do this 5 different times, I'll copy it and then do a paste special and just paste the value into this cell. There's one, $463. It regenerates to $491. Let me copy that and paste it here. Again, I'm just pasting the values that are randomly generated. Third one is $484. Paste the value. Fourth one, $460. Fifth one's $439. So I have 5 randomly generated values, and if I average those, this is a bit more stable answer to compare to rather than just one at 490 or 430. I can count on this number a little bit more.
That's it for lesson 2. See you back for lesson 3.